While building roads may not be the most exciting task to perform on the moon, it's a vital one. It's not just roads though. Before a habitat can be positioned, a launch and landing pad constructed, harvesting equipment placed, the ground must be prepared first. Engineers call this process grading, clearing debris, leveling the surface, compacting it and treating it to prevent loose regolith from shifting under load. Failure to do this risks slips or damage to equipment when vehicles pass over the ground, and perhaps in the worst case, loss of expensive and difficult to replace equipment as it topples over or becomes stuck. If that happens on the moon, no roadside assistance is available. If equipment sinks into the ground or into divots, it could be impossible to recover without big and heavy cranes. This is why the ground must be carefully prepared and treated before any heavy equipment can pass over it. Just think of some of the tasks that are needed to establish a permanently manned base on the moon. Unloading cargo from lunar landers, unloading cargo to be returned to Earth, transporting heavy loads, lifting and positioning structures, collecting and transporting tons of lunar soil for habitat radiation protection, and assembling large facilities such as a nuclear power plant. You can see why lunar infrastructure such as roads, unpressurized shelters for storage of rovers, and other excavation equipment and launch and landing pads would be helpful. Let's first examine, in more detail, why roads are needed at all. Can't we do what the Apollo missions did and just drive over the lunar surface? The traction problem. A lunar vehicle would be more likely to slide or lose grip on a road with divots or uneven ground due to the moon's low gravity, which reduces the normal force pressing the vehicle against the surface and lowers friction. Uneven features like divots would worsen this by causing wheels to lose consistent contact, leading to bouncing, sinkage or slippage, as seen with the Apollo lunar roving vehicle on loose regolith slopes. To counter low friction, rovers can travel at slower speeds to maintain good contact, increase friction and reduce kinetic energy, minimizing bounce severity. Wider wheels increase surface area for better grip, while grousers, protrusions or cleats on wheels, dig into regolith for mechanical interlocking, as used in the Apollo LLV's chevron treads. Tracked vehicles similar to tanks offer even greater traction by distributing weight over a larger area, though they add complexity. Consider transporting a conceptual ESA moon village habitat weighing 7,195 kilos and standing 15.5 meters tall in its stowed configuration. With a center of gravity at 7.75 meters, assuming even mass distribution, it has a tipping angle of about 18 degrees, making it highly susceptible to toppling on uneven lunar ground. The moon's low gravity reduces the stabilizing force. Gravity is restoring torque by a factor of 6 compared to Earth, while the forward inertial force from a lunar terrain's vehicle's engine remains unchanged. This imbalance means minor tilts from divots, bumps or slopes can shift the center of mass beyond the base, risking a topple. Bouncing in low gravity worsens this as vehicles float longer, amplifying uncontrolled rotations or slides, similar to recent lunar lander tipovers during descent. Based on historical data from the Apollo program, the maximum speed of a lunar rover over unprepared lunar ground is 8 to 10 kilometers per hour. The Apollo LRV achieved bursts of 13 to 18 kilometers per hour over short distances, but was operationally restricted to 6 to 8 kilometers per hour for safety. Modern simulations confirm exceeding 10 kilometers per hour greatly increases the risks of accidents, particularly with low wheel loads. It's likely Artemis rovers will be capped at similar speeds on unprepared ground, preventing exploration far from the lunar base. This constraint poses challenges for the Artemis base camp, likely located 5 to 13 kilometers from Shackleton Crater's floor, a key target for water ice resources. With Artemis spacesuits limited to 8-hour EVAs, and realistically 6.5 hours with safety margins, and constrained vehicle battery life, exploration potential is severely restricted without prepared surfaces. Moving across unprepared terrain requires zigzag paths to avoid steep 25 to 35 degree slopes, where low gravity causes traction loss, further extending travel distances. Building lunar roads is therefore critical. Stable, compacted or sintered surfaces enable faster, safer travel, connecting the base camp to landing pads, habitats and resource sites like Shackleton Crater. This infrastructure unlocks greater scientific, exploratory and commercial opportunities, supporting a sustainable human presence on the moon. Major infrastructure elements needed for a manned lunar base. Three major infrastructure elements come to mind when thinking about lunar infrastructure. These elements would also apply on other planets or moons. Launch and landing pads, or LLPs. Launch and landing pads are a top priority to reduce dust and debris kicked up by rocket exhaust during arrivals and departures. Using locally sourced materials, these pads are constructed through techniques like microwave sintering or laser melting, create durable, stable surfaces. NASA aims to achieve Technology Readiness Level 6 for subscale demonstrations by the late 2020s, paving the way for full-scale pads to support reusable landers like SpaceX's Starship, ensuring safe operations for the Artemis base camp. Roads. Roads connect base components, such as habitats and landing pads, to key exploration sites, like Shackleton Crater's permanently shadowed regions, which hold scientific and commercial potential for water ice extraction. These paths enable efficient travel for NASA's Lunar Terrain Vehicle, currently under evaluation with a design selection soon, and JAXA's Lunar Cruiser, a pressurized rover capable of extended missions. Graded and sintered roads provide stable, dust-reduced routes for faster and safer travel. Unpressurized shelters. Unpressurized shelters, including blast shields, berms, and basic structures, offer radiation protection and secure storage for equipment like rovers and excavation tools. In early phases, these serve as emergency shelters or utility spaces, evolving into advanced habitats using 3D printed regolith composites. These shelters improve safety and protection of equipment as the Artemis base camp grows over time. Equipment needed for lunar infrastructure construction. Constructing lunar infrastructure such as roads, landing pads, and habitats requires specialized equipment to collect, process, and move tons of regolith while preparing stable surfaces. Let's look at some of the equipment that will be needed. Mobile boom crane. A mobile boom crane is essential for lifting cargo off lunar landers and surface transporters and positioning regolith for habitat radiation shielding. A number of attachments could include a hoisting hook and cargo sling for lifting heavy loads, a soil transfer bucket for moving regolith, and a pile driving ram to secure anchors for structural stability. Soil excavator and surface grader leveler. Excavation and grading are handled by a front end loader equipped with multiple application bucket, functioning as a shovel, bulldozer blade or scraper. A compactor roll attachment compacts the lunar surface to create stable roads or pads. Adding regolith ballast to the vehicle increases traction in low gravity. Haulers, flatbed cargo transporters fitted with mounting cradles, secure and move large infrastructure elements across the lunar surface. Dedicated soil transport trucks are necessary for rapidly relocating large volumes of regolith, supporting tasks like filling craters or building berms. Auxiliary equipment. Supporting equipment ensures operational efficiency and safety. Lunar terrain vehicle transports crew to and from construction sites. Ramp or chute helps to unload cargo from landers in non-standard scenarios. Rock and soil drills break up large boulders or support extensive excavation, potentially using blasting for efficiency. This equipment enables robust site preparation and construction, laying the foundation for a sustainable Artemis base camp. Preparing roads, grading, leveling, and paving. A roadway ensures low-risk travel between destinations, such as landing pad and habitats. Permanent landing pads will likely be placed several kilometers away from the base to avoid blast damage and debris from landings and launches, plus margin against navigation errors. The width of the road is defined as the width of the largest rover plus a clearance factor. Previous NASA studies, such as a study linked in the video description, suggests a road width of 12 meters, that's 39 feet. This is calculated by assuming moving a lunar lander with a width of 10 meters plus a 2 meter margin. Preparing a lunar road involves a leveling operation known as grading. Crews or autonomous robots first survey the terrain to map a suitable path, filling craters and depressions with regolith while leveling humps and ridges. A 1990 NASA study estimates that a 30,000 square meter road surface requires excavating 2,300 cubic meters for cut and fill operations, where material from high points fills low areas. Large boulders must be moved or buried, with smaller rocks pushed aside or added into fills. Larger obstacles may require drilling, blasting, or mechanical breaking. Fine grading ensures an even surface, followed by compaction using vibratory rollers or equipment passes to achieve 80 to 95% soil density, reducing dust, boosting load-bearing strength. Tiling could be considered. It would be the most time-consuming and difficult, but results in the longest-lasting surface. Sintering can be used as an alternative. Microwave sintering for lunar landing pads. From the Cost of Lunar Landing Pads report by Metzger and Autry, linked in the description, they found a landing pad could be constructed for $299 million, assuming a reduction in transport costs to $100,000 per kilo. The current rate is 10 times that, but the assumption is with competition, costs will drop. A 100 kilowatt nuclear power plant, planned for the Artemis base camp, would lower the cost of power and enable construction during the lunar night, reducing costs and construction time. In summary, landing pads can be built on the moon for a low cost, due to economies of scale. This is well within the capability of privately funded space startups. It simply requires contracts from NASA or other space agencies to begin work. Now, let's look at a number of space startups that are already working on lunar infrastructure construction. Several space startups and established companies are developing technologies for lunar road and infrastructure construction, supporting NASA's Artemis program. Here's a look at four key players and their contributions. Redwire Mason Project. Redwire's Mason Project develops a suite of tools for lunar and Martian infrastructure, including landing pads, roads, berms, and habitat foundations. The system comprises three components: a grader for leveling, a compaction tool for stabilizing surfaces, and microwave sintering tool to solidify regolith into durable material. Having passed its critical design review in June 2025, Mason is now seeking flight opportunities for lunar testing. Icon Technologies Project Olympus. Texan-based Icon Technologies specializes in 3D printing for advanced construction. Their Project Olympus, backed by a $57.2 million NASA grant, uses a large-scale 3D printer to process lunar regolith via laser melting and microwave sintering. This enables the construction of landing pads, blast shields, roads, habitats, and shelters. Icon's prior work includes the 1,700-square-foot Mars Dune Alpha Analog Habitat at NASA's Johnson Space Center, demonstrating their expertise in ISRU-based construction for Artemis. Astroport and XArc Lunatron System. Astroport and its parent company, XArc, focuses on lunar landing pads and surface systems through its Lunatron system. Funded by NASA grants, Lunatron enables excavation, sieving, grading, compaction, and 3D printing of regolith into bricks, rebar, fibers, and geotextiles for roads, foundations, and resource extraction facilities. Ethos Space Resources Regolith Melting. Ethos Space Resources develops technology to melt regolith into a concrete-like material for landing pads. Tested successfully in a $2 million simulated lunar environment for resilience against rocket exhaust. Partnering with Astrolab, an Artemis LTV provider, Ethos deploys a heating trailer towed by Astrolab's Flex rover to construct pads for large landers like SpaceX's Starship. Their Pantheon system also extracts liquid oxygen, supporting propellant production. These companies, through the use of lunar resources and robotics, are paving the way for the construction of lunar infrastructure, supporting NASA's missions for sustainable return to the moon and future missions to Mars. Final thoughts. As NASA and its international partners prepare for Artemis missions to establish a permanent lunar presence, building robust infrastructure is critical. Roads not only connect habitats to landing pads, but enable exploration further from the base, unlocking valuable scientific and commercial resources. Did I cover all the major infrastructure elements needed for a lunar base? Did I miss any methods for lunar construction? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a copy to help support more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with late-breaking space news and previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.